Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to Grace Church. If you're here or if you're on our viewing platform, we say welcome to you to the third Sunday in Easter. Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, whose blessed Son made himself known to his disciples in the breaking of bread, open the eyes of our faith that we may behold him in all his redeeming work, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The first reading is from the Acts of the Apostles. Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any who belonged to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Now, as he was going along and approaching Damascus, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" He asked, "Who are you, Lord?" The reply came, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But get up and enter the city, and you will be told what you are to do." The men who were traveling with him stood speechless because they heard the voice, but saw no one. Saul got up from the ground, and though his eyes were open, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. For 3 days he was without sight and neither ate nor drank. Now there was a disciple in Damascus named Ananias. The Lord said to him in a vision, "Ananias," he answered, "Here I am, Lord." The Lord said to him, "Get up and go to the street called Straight, and at the house of Judas, look for a man of Tarsus named Saul. At this moment, he is praying, and he has seen in a vision a man named Ananias come in and lay his hands on him so that he might regain his sight." But Ananias answered, "Lord, I have heard from many about this man, how much evil he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priests to bind all who invoke your name." But the Lord said to him, "Go, for he is an instrument whom I have chosen to bring my name before Gentiles and kings and before the people of Israel. I myself will show him how much he must suffer for the sake of my name." So Ananias went and entered the house. He laid his hands on Saul and said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on your way here, he has sent me so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." And immediately, something like scales fell from his eyes and his sight was restored. Then he got up and was baptized. And after taking some food, he regained his strength. For several days, he was with the disciples in Damascus, and immediately he began to proclaim Jesus in the synagogue, saying, "He is the Son of God." The word of the Lord.
Sing praise to the Lord, O Lord. The second reading is from the book of Revelation. I looked, and I heard the voice of many angels surrounding the throne, and the living creatures and the elders. They numbered myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands, singing with full voice. Worthy is the Lamb that was slaughtered to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing. Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them singing, to the one seated on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever. And the four living creatures said, Amen. And the elders fell down and worshiped. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Savior Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you,
Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But by this time, the boat, battered by the waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning, he came walking toward them on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It is a ghost." And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he noticed the strong wind, he became frightened, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshiped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." The Gospel of the Lord. And Jesus was a sailor when he walked upon the water, and he spent a long time watching from his lonely wooden tower. And when he knew for certain only drowning men could see him, he said, "All men will be sailors then, until the sea shall free them." But he himself was broken long before the sky would open. Forsaken, almost human, he sank beneath your wisdom like a stone. And you want to travel with him. And you want to travel blind. And you think maybe you'll trust him, for he's touched your perfect body with his mind. The words of my favorite Jewish Buddhist poet and songwriter, Leonard Cohen, from his very first wildly popular song, Suzanne. As with so much good poetry, Cohen's meaning here is not immediately clear. We can puzzle over the words and analyze them to death, but in the end, the best thing to do is to let the words wash over us. Just sit with them. I certainly don't know exactly what Cohen means by it all, but I do know that these words have a meaning for me, a meaning too deep for words. They invite me to see today's gospel as much more than just a really awesome miracle story. It's suddenly my story. It's all our stories. Today's reading begins right after the feeding of the 5,000 with loaves and fishes. Remember that when the disciples first saw those 5,000 ravenously hungry people who had been with Jesus all day, he'd been curing them and talking to them, the disciples basically said, "Let's get out of here. Let's blow this pop stand." But Jesus had compassion and love for the people who had come to see him that day. So he made sure they were fed. As today's gospel begins, all that feeding has been taken care of. Jesus and the disciples are on the east side of the Sea of Galilee. At this point, Jesus does want to be alone. He makes all of them get into a boat to go to the other side of the lake. He compels them to leave him because he yearns for a bit of peace and quiet. Matthew wrote this gospel for a Jewish community of Christians who weren't even called Christians yet. It must have been very meaningful to that Jewish audience that Jesus went up a mountain to pray. Like Moses, he ascends the mountain to be alone with God, with his Father. In the meantime, the disciples are in big trouble. They are being tossed about by a storm. The boat is battered by the waves. Most of the men were intrepid fishermen, so this must have been an extraordinarily frightful storm. Then early in the morning, between 3 and 6 a.m., someone comes walking toward them on the water. Tired and traumatized by the storm, they fear a ghost walks toward them. But Jesus calmly speaks to them. The literal translation of the Greek is, "Take heart, I am. Do not be afraid." That "I am" also spoke directly to Matthew's Jewish readers. Those words must have been so meaningful for them. Not only does Jesus do what only God can do, have power over the chaos of the wind and the waves on the lake, but Jesus is the "I am," the exact words with which Yahweh, God, identifies God's self in the Old Testament. And then Jesus says, "Do not be afraid." I know I've mentioned before that those words appear in the Bible 365 times, one for every day of the year, which can't be just an interesting coincidence. So the storm is still raging, and Peter, in what must have been a momentary lapse of reason, challenges Jesus, "Lord, if it's you, command me to come to you on the water." It's insane, but Peter obviously believes that his Jesus is so powerful, he can work miracles through others. And Jesus does call him. He says, "Come." So Peter steps out of the boat and walks on water. But he takes his eyes off Jesus. He's distracted. He has that terrorized Wile E. Coyote look. The one where Wile E. realizes he's just run off the edge of a mountain and is walking frantically on thin air. And then he plummets to the ground. Fear pulls Peter away from his focus. The wind is so strong. He sinks and calls out what we all call out in desperate times, "Lord, save me." And Jesus does, asked and answered. And then Jesus says, in what I think must have been a gentle, chiding way, "You have little faith. Why did you doubt?" Whenever Jesus says that to people in the Gospels, it is to people who do believe. They are people like us, who have taken the word into their hearts. But when the storm rages and peril surrounds us, fear wears away at our courage and theirs, just as it happens. There is trust in them and in us, and there is also doubt. The Greek word translated doubt in this passage does not connote skepticism or disbelief. It connotes vacillation. When Jesus and Peter finally arrive at the boat, the winds calm and the storm dissipates. As Jesus climbs in, the disciples do not greet him. They do not honor him. They do not praise him. They worship him. Worship being appropriate only for God. Indeed, for the first time in Matthew's gospel, they fully recognize him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." Who among us has not, in desperation, asked Jesus to command us to walk on water? There we are, in dire straits, in a fragile boat, tossed about by a storm. Perhaps we've been traumatized by the death of a loved one, or an addiction, or the loss of a job, or any number of things. Finally, we have nowhere to turn but to Christ. We know we have to do what we believe is impossible, move through the storm, experience it, trust that peace and serenity wait for us on the other side of the tumult. Yeah, that'll be as easy as walking on water. But that spark of faith in us, that same crazy, risk-taking behavior that Peter had, tells us that Jesus can make the seemingly impossible happen. So with trust and confidence, we step out of the boat. Our eyes are on him, and we walk on water like it's solid ground. The storm still rages around us, but our trust and God's grace sustain us. And then we start to worry about the storm, the turmoil in our lives. And that worry turns to fear. We take our eyes off Jesus. We try to take control of our steps on the water. We sink like a stone. And we cry out, Lord, save me. Do not be afraid, he said, 365 times in the Bible. Those words appear again and again because they are the key. The key to becoming who we must become. The key to doing what we must do. The key to keeping our eyes on Jesus. But we sink into the water like a stone. And then an arm, Jesus' arm, reaches down into the deep to pull us to safety. We begin again. We step on the water and walk through our pain, putting aside fear, trusting that grace will see us through, trusting that peace and serenity await us. We want to travel with him. We want to travel blind. And we think maybe we'll trust him, for he's touched our perfect bodies with his mind. Amen.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us join together with the prayers of the people. Set free from captivity to sin and death, we pray to the God of resurrection for the church, people in need, and all of creation. Holy One of new beginnings, fill us with new life. Send us into the world as you sent your apostle Paul to invite people to come and see your wondrous acts in Christ. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Revive ecosystems along coastlands that have been devastated by natural forces and human negligence. Reestablish plant and animal life that purifies air and water, and that feeds humans and other living creatures. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Accompany laborers who get little rest from their work. Give them hope when they struggle to produce what they need. Give all who labor fair treatment and just wages. God, in your mercy. Restore all people who cry to you for help. Turn their mourning into dancing. Clothe them with joy, and put a testimony of healing and praise on their lips. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Be present to faithful ones who are persecuted for following you. Sustain them by your faithfulness, and give them strength in the name of Jesus. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We thank you for the gracious, inspiring, and fun leadership and pastoral care by our beloved Associate Rector Donna during the past 5 years. Support and guide Reverend Donna in her new calling as Rector at St. Benedict, and let our love follow her into her new journey. God, in your mercy, join our voices with angels, creatures, and all the saints in praising Christ and bestowing upon him all blessing and honor and glory. Reveal Christ's glory to us and through us in our worship. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
In your mercy, O God, respond to these prayers and renew us by your life-giving Spirit, through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. And the peace of the risen Christ be always with you.
My name is Mike Asher. I'm part of the senior leadership team, or the lay leadership team here at Grace Church, and just have a couple of announcements for your direction. First of all, as you just heard, this is Donna's last Sunday with us. We will have a nice reception after. I would ask you all to join us in the parish hall to send Donna off with a couple of tokens of our appreciation. And it's already set up back there, and it's so great to see the hospitality ministry back in action. Awesome. So please join us after the service. Couple of other notes. Ann Heilman, I am finally going to remember to ask. The vestry needs a new clerk. Ann has been doing double duty as a vestry member and an awesome one at that, and continuing her ministry as the clerk of the vestry. We need to relieve Anne so that she can focus on the good work of being a vestry member. So all you do to be a clerk is to come and see me or email the church office. That the duties are to take minutes at the vestry meetings, which occur basically on the second Monday of every month. So if you are interested in being the clerk, that would be great. You have big shoes to fill, because Anne is quite good at it, but we can train you up. So please consider that and get in touch with me if you'd like to do that. The Men of Grace are going to have another fireside chat Thursday, May 12th. David Ortiz will be leading us from 7 to 9. That's been in the Guild Room. Or join us outside of the East Portico. Okay, all right, it's going to be outside. hopefully. I was up here for Easter, and I almost said Merry Christmas. It was so cold. And finally, on May 8th, the Reverend Chilton Knudsen, she is the retired Bishop of Maine, will be visiting Grace Church. That is next week, and we will have confirmation. There is still, if you would like to be confirmed, get in touch with the church office. But we have a few confirmands that are looking forward to being confirmed next Sunday. For your spiritual direction, I would point you to Grace Notes. I'm not going to run through all of the opportunities for spiritual growth that we have here, but there are quite a few. They happen every day, pretty much, and I would commend them. I participate in a prayer call every morning at 7 o'clock during the week. It's a great and profound way to start my day, and there are all sorts of different opportunities for spiritual growth here at Grace Church. Did I miss anything? All right. Please join us afterwards, and have a great week.
Ascribe to the Lord the honor to his name. Bring your offerings and come into his courts. Out of our devotion, we continue to pray for Ukraine. God of peace and justice, we pray for the people of Ukraine today. We pray for peace and the laying down of weapons. We pray for all those who fear for tomorrow, that your spirit of comfort would draw near to them. We pray for those with power over war or peace, for wisdom, discernment, and compassion to guide their decisions. Above all, we pray for your precious children at risk and fear, that you would hold and protect them. We pray in the name of Jesus, the Prince of Peace. Amen. Amen. This Holy Eucharist is offered up to the glory of God for you, Donna, for your priesthood, for your time with us, for your humor, for your expert rendering of movies. Thank you. I invite you all to stand as you're able to do so. Saying together the Iona invitation, this is the table, not of the church, but of Jesus Christ. It is made ready for those who love him and who want to love him more. So come, you who have much faith and you who have little, you who have been here often, and you who have not been for a long time or ever before, you who have tried to follow and you have failed. Come not because the church invites you, it is Christ and he invites you to meet him here. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give them thanks and praise.
It is right to lift our hearts to you, Almighty God, for your Spirit brooded over the waters before the foundation of the world. Your pillar of fire led your people to freedom through the waters of the Red Sea. And your Son, Jesus, came to his disciples across the stormy waves of Galilee. In his agonizing death, we see how far we stray from you. And in his resurrection, we see how you draw close despite our betrayals and our failures. We long for the day when all the saints adore thee, casting down their golden crowns around the glassy sea with angels and all the company of heaven singing this hymn of your unending praise. You remain standing or kneel or sit as your piety calls you to do. We thank you and praise you, Lord God, because in Jesus you come to us, call us to you, lift us up when we fear and fail and fall, and stay with us through the storm. Come among us now through the power of your Spirit, that we may be transformed into your likeness, and that these gifts of bread and wine may be for us the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, who at supper with his disciples took bread, gave thanks, broke the bread, and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup. Again, he gave you thanks and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Everlasting God, you promise us the righteousness that comes from faith, and you assure us that everyone who calls upon your name will be saved. Be close to all who struggle to believe. Make yourself known to any who have never heard. Empower those who are called to proclaim, and bless the ones you have sent. Visit those who are hungry. Be among them as the bread of life. Comfort any who are thirsty. Restore them with your fountain of living waters. Strengthen all who are at sea in the trials and travails of life. Come to them across the waters and make your home with them. We pray in union with Christ in the power of your Holy Spirit, who helps us in our weakness and intercedes with his sighs too deep for words. Father of all, now and forever. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Behold what you are. As you go to the sick and the homebound, take with you not only the sacrament we have celebrated, but also the word of God which we have heard, as well as the affection of this parish community. Ask for the prayers of those whom you visit in return. Go then with God's peace and blessing. Amen. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever.
Go forth loving Christ because you want to travel with him. You know you'll travel blind, and you think maybe you'll trust him, but he's touched your perfect body with his mind. Alleluia. Alleluia.
Thanks be to God.